Hello, friends. May Jesus be with all of us today and always. Welcome to the program Spiritist Teachings, where we are going to show you classes of the course Basic Notions of Spiritism. The course Basic Notions of Spiritism is the first course of the introductory cycle of studies of the Spiritist Center. Today, you're going to watch the class about Plurality of the Inhabited Worlds. And if you want to reproduce this class in your Spiritist Center, pay attention to the material that we use in each class. So first, we use this book called Get to Know Spiritism. And this book contains all the 14 classes, and it's used in every single class by all students. We also have a book that we use in the moment of self-enlightenment called Agenda of Self-Enlightenment. This book is not just used during the classes, but also at home, every day at home, as a method of self-enlightenment. We also use a book from Emmanuel called 2,000 Years Ago. This is the book of the support of our studies, used in the moment of self-enlightenment as well. In every class, you're also going to need an attendance sheet that we're going to take attendance every class at the beginning of each class. For every class, you're going to find in our website that is here on the screen, and you can go online and you'll find a lot of materials. You're going to find all the slides as well as the plan of class, of each class, explaining each moment, what we're going to be using, suggestions of techniques, of group studies, and so on. So for the class today, the instructor will be Maria Mesquita. May you all have a great class. Enjoy. Hello.
Hello, how are you?
Hi, Anna, how are you?
Thank you.
Very good. Hello.
Hello.
Very good. This is for later.
Hi.
Good to see you too.
Thank you.
Hello. Good. Let's take a seat. Welcome, everybody. Nice to see you all again. Today is our class about Plurality of Inhabited Worlds. Did everybody study? Very good, wonderful. So before we begin, we're going to say a prayer, and I invite everybody to close your eyes. As we elevate our thoughts, and we ask the spirits to inspire us during this class, so we can learn, so we can open our minds to this interesting subject about the worlds of the universe. Please help us to understand and to use this knowledge in our daily lives as well. So be it. After our prayer, I'm going to begin with our attendance. Let's see if everybody's here today. Julio?
Here.
Good. Magda?
Here.
Alice? And Anna?
Here.
All right. Thank you so much for coming. And we're going to begin our class with our first moment, the moment of self-enlightenment. And as we always begin, we're going to pair so you can have a little conversation with your friend about your week. You can talk about your accomplishments this week, any problems, things, important things that happened to your week. And don't forget that Jesus is here with us today, and he's going to participate with our conversation. So you guys can get together, as well as you too.
Just
Well, now we are done with the first moment, fraternal conversation. Is it good, right? It's nice to talk a little bit, have some time to tell a little bit about us, know what happened with our friends. Now we're going to go to our second moment of the self-enlightenment, which is the study support. And we are studying the book 2,000 years ago from Emmanuel. Did everybody read?
Yes.
Did you have a chance? Very good. Today we're going to go to the part two of the book, chapter one, The Death of Flaminius. And would anybody would like to share with us your thoughts and your impressions about the book? Well, so this chapter about Flaminius' death is interesting because we all know that Flaminius was Publius' best friend. And then he dies, and it was a moment for Publius to reflect a lot about his life and about his mistakes, because he used to consider this friend a lot. And as we read, the objective of reading this book is that we make a connection with our own lives, with our own reflections, with our own mistakes in life. That's the purpose. And this will help us with our self-enlightenment. And now we're going to go to the third part, 10 minutes of our weekly evaluation. So everybody is invited individually to go over your week, evaluate this week, again, your accomplishments, the things that could have been better, the things that you are proud of yourself, and so on. But before we do that, I'm going to invite Magda to read the page of today, our evaluation week.
Reflection on the Gospel. And our hope for you is firm, because we know that just as you share in our sufferings, so also you share in our comfort. Goal of the month, developing hope. If you find yourself in front of people with the desire to help you, if you propose to contribute to the regeneration of the social field, do not get lost in preaching rebellion and despair. Goal of the day, support the most anguished hearts, radiating the light of hope as source of peace and comfort. Suggestion for your daily prayer. Prayer for those that suffer beyond the grave.
Please make sure you do the program at home of the Enlightenment program, because this is such a good opportunity for us to improve ourselves. And if we take it seriously, it's very good. It brings results for each one of us. So right now, we are going to begin our seventh class of the book, Get to Know Espiritism. And who remembers, what was our last class? Discarnation. Very good. And now we're going to talk about the many worlds in the universe, and if there is life. Because sometimes we wonder, all these planets, all this infinitude of the universe, and we wonder if there's life in other planets. Today, we're going to try to review the Spiritist view on this subject, and it's very specific. But before we do that, I'm going to ask you, do you think that nobody ever thought about life in other planets before Spiritism? What do you think?
I think many people were right.
Yes. Yes. And we're going to begin with our first slide. And we're going to talk about this ancient belief about life in other planets. And we're going to begin with the dream of Cipriani in Rome. Cipriani was a general, a Roman general, that lived almost 200 years before Jesus Christ. And he has a book, there is a book called Of the Republic, where he tells us about an important dream that he had once. Very interesting. And he tells us during this dream, he was able to first see his father, see his grandfather, and his grandfather came to him to give him advice. As we know, the Romans before Jesus Christ, a few centuries before Jesus Christ, had the Roman Empire. So they were conquering other countries and other lands and expanding their empire. And Cipriani was one of these generals. He used to conquer lands. And his grandfather came to him and showed him a part of the universe, a part of the our galaxy with so many planets. And he was able to see Earth. And look what he tells us. Those starry globes immensely exceeded Earth in magnitude. Our earthly dwelling made me feel ashamed for its smallness. Of our empire, which occupied the unlimited space, only a noticeable point. So basically, this person that was full of himself, a Roman general, conquering many lands, he was able to see many planets, this starry sky, and Earth very little, barely noticeable. And that made him think about how small we are. And seeing how small Earth was, he even felt ashamed with that. And then he continues, his grandfather, who had a nickname of the African, because he was also one of the leaders of the Roman Empire when he was alive. And he also conquered parts of Africa. So they both had this nickname of African. And he says to Cipriani, I see that you observe now the abode of man. If it looks small to you, as it really is, disdain human things and direct your eyes to the sky. And above all, notice how narrow is the sphere in which your ephemeral glory wants to dilate. So this is a very nice dream that he had. His grandfather, even before Jesus Christ, first they talked about a little bit about life after death. And then he was mentioning to Cipriani how small we are on earth and how prideful he was because of the Roman Empire. And he's inviting Cipriani to look beyond our earth, to look at the skies, to look at the things above us all. So that's a very good introduction. In order for us to really understand a little bit more about how small we are, we brought a video today. And this video is going to show us the size of Earth in relation to some of other planets and some of the stars known to humankind. So let's watch.
Thank you.
Did you like the movie?
Yes.
That's very interesting, right? It's so interesting to see how small we are. Do you remember compared to that big star? Earth is almost like a noticeable, a little dot compared to that big star. And it's very interesting how many of us can think that God prepared all this universe and life just on Earth. Doesn't make a lot of sense. But for our reflection, we're going to study a few books. So Kardec, in the Spirit's book, he asked the spirits, are all the globes that revolve in space inhabited? Well, before we read the answer, it's so interesting that Kardec asked, he didn't ask, is there life in other globes? He asks, are all the globes? So he includes all planets. Let's see the answer. So the answer is yes. And the people of Earth are far from being, as you suppose, the first in intelligence, goodness, and general development. So the spirits are very clear. Yes, there is life in all planets of the universe. And then the spirits finish. To believe that the presence of living beings is confined to the one point of the universe inhabited by us is to doubt the wisdom of God, who has made nothing in vain. Doesn't it make sense? So if we consider life just on Earth, it means that all these stars, all these beautiful planets, that sometimes are smaller, sometimes are bigger, sometimes are different colors, they're all made in vain by God. No, God doesn't do anything in vain. And continuing here, we are going to study what Jesus said. So Jesus referred to other places in the house of my Father. He said, there are many dwellings in the house of my Father. First of all, who is Jesus' Father? God, right? So he is referring to God. So what is the house of my God, of God? Let's see the answer. And this is Allan Kardec in the Gospel According to Spiritism. The house of the Father is the universe. The different mansions are the worlds which circulate in infinite space and offer the spirits who incarnate on them dwelling places that correspond to their progress. So Kardec is saying that the universe is the house of God that offers many places, many homes, many places where the spirits can live. And these places will differ according to the progress of the spirits that live there. So he's introducing the notion of different worlds. And as we continue seeing here, this is Aureo in the book Universe and Life. He says, there are non-galactic masses with more than 100 galaxies. Those countless worlds are, as Jesus said, the many dwellings of the house of the Eternal Father. It is on them that the Creator's children are born, grow, live, and perfect themselves, the great universal family. They are the great schools of the souls, the great workshops of the spirit, the great universities and laboratories of the infinite. So the planets are places where we are going to live, where we are going to learn, and where we are going to evolve. And we know that science has even talked about other universes, not mentioning what Aureo is reminding us, hundreds of galaxies. And in our galaxy, we know that there are many suns, many stars, right? With all their systems of planets circulating around each star, each sun. So definitely Kardec and Aureo are reminding us of this beautiful idea of the universal family. Because if we have friends and if we have sisters and brothers in other planets, they are also part of our universal family. All right, so now, to begin and to facilitate our understanding, we are going to separate our group in four little groups. As you know, we are such a small group today. The weather's not helping today. So we are going to do, we're going to make four groups of one person each. And each one of you will have instructions, and we're going to study a little bit further into our book about the subject, okay? Do you remember the little card I gave to you? So that corresponds to the group you are. So group one will be here, Inferior Worlds. Group two over there, Worlds of Tests and Expiations. Three and four. And you can go there, take your chair. And I'm going to give you instructions, okay? So basically, on these cards, you're going to read the instruction of the item that you're going to read from our book and two questions that you're going to answer, okay? So group one, two, three, and four, okay? So refer to your book, and in the book, you're going to find that item to study. All right, everybody's done?
Yeah.
Very good. So now I'm going to call each group to come here. So please, Alice, come here. And you're going to choose one card that you believe is the characteristics of the world that you studied. Very good. You can take a tape. And we're going to start building up a chart over here. So you can place over here. And I'm going to ask Alice to read to the rest of the class, okay?
Vej intuition of the supreme being.
Okay. Now I'll invite Julio from group number two. You're going to try to find characteristics of the world. And you can put over here. And please read to the rest of the group.
Where evil dominates, places of exile for spirits that are rebellious to the law of God, superiority of intelligence.
Very good. Thank you. All right. Does anybody recognize any of these? Yeah, this looks very familiar to us, correct? Now I'm going to invite Anna, group number three, to do the same, please. If you disagree with what they chose, please let us know. So, worlds of regeneration.
Dawn of happiness and not perfect happiness, yet a man of flesh and blood. Existence of test, but without the anguish of atonement. Man envisions better future. Man is still fallible, possibly of falling back to worlds of atonement.
Thank you so much. All right. So this is our goal for the near future, world of regeneration. Okay? Now I'm going to invite Magda, group number four, please. Thank you. Would you like to read for us?
Everlasting joy, undisturbed by the troubles of material life or the contact with evil, that there they do not have access.
Thank you so much. All right, please take a seat. Very good. So I guess you deserve applause. Very nice, very nice. And does anybody have a guess of where Earth is in this classification?
Worlds of terraces and expiations.
Very good. So Earth is going to be over here, and it is we are doing a transition right now to a world of regeneration. That is better than what we have right now. So now we're going to go back to our semicircle. Please, you guys can come back. All right. Thank you so much. Now we are going to finish our board over here of the different categories of inhabited worlds. We're going to finish the other characteristics of
now
each world.
Now that we are done
okay?
with our board, with different categories of inhabited worlds,
and we saw those many characteristics that we find in the Gospel According to Spiritism of each world, and I don't know if you noticed, but these characteristics are not of the planet itself. It's of the population of spirits that live in that planet. So as we evolve, the category of the world will evolve as well. And Earth, as we said before, is passing through a transition between world of tests and expiations to the world of regeneration, which was going to be better, like a rest between, difficulties in this world to a happier world, a blessed world in the future. So we are going to continue with our slides. So Allan Kardec in the Gospel According to Spiritism, he says the conditions of the various worlds differ one from the other with respect to the degree of elevation or inferiority of their inhabitants. That's exactly what we said before. As we evolve, the world evolves as well. The worlds in this that we studied here, we call the Spiritist scale, that will talk a little bit about each planet, each type of planet. Although it is not possible to make an absolute classification of the different worlds, of course, this is not absolute. This is just for us to have an idea of the types of planets and dwelling places that we can live. We can at least divide them in general terms according to the state in which they are in and the purpose they present in the following manner. So the first classification will be primitive worlds or inferior worlds destined to receive the initial incarnations of the human soul. As we saw, they have vague intuition of God, savage races, gross instincts. So the life is really, really material and is for the first incarnations. And then we can go to the next category, worlds of tests and expiations, where Earth is located right now. And in that planet, evil still predominates. So right now on Earth, we have numerous vices, passions reign sovereignly. We expiate our faults through painful work and miseries of life. So life in the planet of tests and expiations is very hard, very difficult. As we move on a little bit, we go to the worlds of regeneration. And in these worlds, of regeneration, they serve as a transition between those of expiation and those of happiness. The penitent soul finds calm and rest on them and can continue the purifying process. However, perfect happiness still does not exist in these worlds, only the dawning of happiness. So this is our next step. We're not going to be angels yet. We're going to be a little bit better. We're going to be
leaving behind a lot of the evil in us. So it's going to be like a transition to a happy world. But complete happiness is not going to exist in these worlds as well as on Earth right now. So blessed worlds where goodness outweighs evil. So right now, world of test and expiation, evil dominates. Evil predominates. In the blessed worlds, goodness predominates. This is a great news. And Earth will reach that point at some point. And then celestial or divine worlds, inhabited by purified spirits, where only goodness exists. This part of the class is so nice, so interesting. Remember, Aureo introduced the idea of our universal family. We also studied that in the Gospel According to Spiritism. But now we're going to learn a little bit about the solidarity between these worlds. There are many different planets, but they are not completely isolated from each other. They have solidarity among them. So, for example, Aureo again will talk about the evolvement of some planets in relation to Earth. And he cites Sirius first, of the constellation of Great Dog, reached the position of regeneration world. Many proud and rebellious spirits that inhabited Sirius were transferred to Capella, of the constellation of Coachman, which was at that time a system of worlds of trials and expiations. So here, Aureo is talking about Sirius and Capella. So when Sirius reached a world of regeneration, the spirits that were not able to continue and to learn, they were not ready for that world of regeneration, they were exiled to Capella. That was a world of test and expiation. So basically, it was almost like a new start in that category. Very painful, very difficult, because they were evolved intellectually, but morally, they still had to evolve a little bit better to deserve to live in a regeneration planet. This didn't happen only with Sirius and Capella. It also happened with Capella and Earth. So what is the spiritual position of Capella? So almost all the worlds that are dependent from it already physically and morally purified themselves. Many millennia ago, one of the orbs of Capella, which holds many affinities with the terrestrial globe, reached the culmination of one of its extraordinary evolutionary cycles. This is Emmanuel in the book On the Way to the Light. So basically, Capella also reached the category of world of expiations, and those spirits that were not ready moved out to Earth. All right? This was many millennia ago. Emmanuel cites more than 40 millennia ago. So it's been a long time when these spirits came. And they came, they lived a little bit on Earth. We know that some came back already, some are still here, and so on. And then many spirits, many rebel spirits moved. Okay, as we said. These spirits, undesirable in Capella, when that system reached the state of regeneration orb, were banished to Earth, where the Christ magnanimity received and supported them. So this is actually a good thing. It's almost like in school. You are not ready to go to second grade. You are going to have to go back to that first stage. But the class continues. So the planet will continue through different grades. If you're not ready, you're going to have to go back, restart. So it's a new chance to restart. And this is Aureo. So Emmanuel and Aureo are saying the same thing. So these planets of the universe, they were created by God. And of course, this evolution, this evolvement from one planet to the next, they don't come by themselves. So these spirits that were exiled, They didn't go by themselves. And we are going to learn a little bit about the great conductors. Such banished spirits, however, did not come along as a huge flock abandoned to the violence of the storms. Auri is so interesting because he cites some very known spirits to us that came from Sirius. But the sublime love of elevated spirits of Sirius did not abandon the old friends, and was from there, from that sanctified orb, that they came since the beginnings of earth to voluntarily assist Jesus Christ, those extraordinary beings that surrounded the Messiah in this world, as Anna and Simeon, Isabel and Zacharias, and especially the carpenter Joseph and the Saint Mary, a Mother Mary. So Jesus' parents and Anna, Simeon, and others came from the orb of Sirius to assist Jesus. So these planets are evolving, but they are not completely disconnected. For the mission of Jesus to come to Earth, none of us could help, but this is spirits from a more evolved planet, all right? And he continues, not only from Sirius these spirits came, but some missionaries came from Capella. Who are they? So it was, however, among the Hebrews, chosen people to receive the divine Messiah, starting from the greatest of all, the great leader of the banished ones on earth, the grandson of Abraham, Jacob. So Jacob was the father of the tribes, and he also came from Capella, right? So again, this mission of Jesus coming to earth was supported by enlightened spirits. Always active and loyal, he would come back later as Moses and Elias to return to the world again in the sublime figure of Baptist. So here, Ariel is talking to us about the multiple lives of one spirit that came from different orbs to help us to evolve. So it's talking about this solidarity among different planets. We are not by ourselves. Just like Jesus. Jesus doesn't belong to Earth. He's the governor of Earth, but he doesn't live here. We know that he lives in the sun, and he came in a mission. Other spirits that came from Capella, such as he, Abraham, that was later Solomon, and later Simon Peter, Isaac, who would be Daniel, and later John the Evangelist, Joseph, the Chancellor of Egypt, which would come to be David, and later Paul of Tarsus. So this is in Universe and Life, showing us not just the continuation of these planets in involvement, but these spirits, as Paul of Tarsus, for example, that we know so much, came also, and was David before, was the Chancellor of Egypt, for example. And now, to me, the best part of the class, thinking about the future of Earth. If we study about these other planets, let's study about Earth now. And in the Gospel and the Future, Emmanuel and the book On the Way to the Light tells us, yes, because after darkness, a new dawn will appear. Comforting lights will involve the entire orb regenerated in the baptism of suffering. The spiritual being will be united to the physical being for its glorious march in the infinite. So Emmanuel is talking about Earth, talking about us evolving and becoming a little bit better. So in the future, the gospel will live inside each one of us. In this renewed world, he's talking about Earth as a planet of regeneration. The unchangeable peace will establish progress with no fear and a civilization without evil. Order and peace will reign on Earth. Universal love will be the divine institute. Earth will belong to the meek. So now Aureo is reminding us of when Jesus said the Beatitudes, the meek will inherit earth, but not this earth right now. An earth that is regenerated, better.
Now we reach the end of our slide, such an interesting subject, and such good news to know that we are on the way to the light,
that our planet that, you know, suffers so much atonements and so many pains will one day be better as we evolve. That's why we are here, to learn a little bit, because we know that these things are going to help us to evolve. And before we finish and say our prayer, I'm going to ask you, do you know these books?
Yes.
So here we have a few examples, On the Way to the Light by Emmanuel. We have Self-Enlightenment from Alto de Souza Publisher, and Genesis. And just a friendly reminder, we always need to look for answers in other books as well. Read a little bit more than just what we are required, so we have more answers to our questions. So now I'm going to invite everybody to say the final prayer so we can go home in peace and we can prepare for our next class. So let's elevate our thoughts again and say thank you to God and the spirits that are here for this moment of study about our lives, about the house of God, about the universe. We are such small creatures trying to understand a little bit of God's creation. And we are pleased to know that as we evolve, we will be able to experience happiness and peace in our hearts. So come with us to our homes and to everywhere we go, and help us to be good examples for our family members and for everybody else. So be it. Right? So before we go, let's give hugs, fraternal hugs, to our friends.
Thank you so much. Very good teacher. Thank you.
Thank you. Very good.
Thank you.